abundance for my ancestors for thousands of years. The Ohlone harvested a local reed called tule to build boats, which allowed them to take advantage of the bay's many resources. The Ohlone dried and bundled the tule reeds, then lashed them together with handmade rope. They fished with nets and hand-carved hooks. They understood nature's rhythms, and Monterey Bay sustained them for countless generations.
I do beg your pardon, Uncle. I never formally introduced myself. I'm Julia Platt. I'm strong to Monterey Bay in the 1900s by stories of the incredible diversity of life in these waters. You see, I was trained as a marine biologist. Something almost unheard of for women my young. I was fascinated by the abundance of life in the bay and along the shore. I was also struck by the surprising diversity of people using the bay to earn a living. People came from all over the world to settle here, seeking a better life. The bay bustled with all manners of boats and people of the likes I had never seen before. Perhaps one of the most interesting places I came upon was a thriving Chinese fishing village situated right where you're seated. I could hear the sound of children laughing and an unfamiliar language spoken by women hanging freshly caught squid out to dry. I felt as though I had traveled halfway around the world.
My name is Jerry Lo Sabado, and this place is very special to me. My ancestors were some of the first residents of a Chinese fishing village called Point Alonis, which was located where the aquarium stands today. Before coming to Monterey, my ancestors were fishermen from the Pearl River Delta in China. Life was very hard for them. When news of the gold rush in California reached their village in 1850, some of the families decided to seek a better life in a place they called the Gold Mountain. Five families set sail from China to California on boats loaded with supplies. The grueling voyage took more than a month, and several of the boats. The older fishermen remembered their time in China and knew that some sea creatures, like squid, could be attracted to the surface at night using bright lights. They suspended wire baskets from the side of their boats and lit a small fire to attract the squid to the water's surface. Once they brought the squid back to shore, they dried and shipped them to China. I'm proud of my ancestors' perseverance. My great-grandparents and the other villagers didn't give up in the face of adversity. By fishing at night for something no one else wanted, they adapted to change. As a result, the first commercial squid fishery in California was born right here in Monterey.
The Chinese were the only ones drawn to our bay. Stories of a shoreline carpeted with abalone as far as the eye could see soon reached Japan. Around 1900, skilled fishermen made the journey to Monterey to take advantage of this incredible bounty.
My name is Larry Oda. My grandfather was a successful businessman in Japan. He was skilled at processing fish. So he was recruited by the Pacific Trading Company. Expand his business, and in 1926, he opened the Sea Pride Cannery right here on Cannery Row.
5 years after I settled in Pacific Grove, right next door to Monterey, a new wave of people arrived. At first, I made the mistake of calling them Italian, but they didn't like that. I was quickly corrected. They were Sicilian, proud of their heritage, distinct language, and culture. The first arrivals came from a small town of Isola della Femmine in the province of Palermo. The Sicilians were renowned for their fishing prowess, but despite their skill, were paid poorly for their animals. Stories of a bay teeming with fish, and the props, fair price for catching them, drew the Sicilians to Monterey. The Sicilians brought with them new knowledge, skills, and techniques, and quickly established themselves as some of the best fishermen the bay had ever seen. What happened next was nothing short of a revolution in fishing, and would change the fate of Monterey.
In 1917, after the United States entered World War I, an order came from the Army. Our men needed food they could carry with them into the battlefield.
Monterey heard the call and answered with one word.
Sardines!
Overnight, huge canneries sprang up, and the Sicilian fishermen worked harder than ever. Some years, the canneries in Monterey processed more fish than anywhere else in the world. An important innovation allowed the Sicilian fishermen to meet this new demand for sardines, a larger boat called a purse seiner. With its huge net, this new boat could catch up to 4 times the fish the smaller boats could catch. It was the mighty sardine that put Monterey on the map. In the 1930s, the silvery tide of sardines earned Monterey the nickname Sardine Capital of the World. People came from all over to fish the bay and work in the canneries.
Each year, as demand grew, new boats arrived with increasingly sophisticated methods to catch more and more sardines.
The cannery shifted into high gear and cannery row buckled and hung. Some biologists warned that they were catching too much too fast, but those warnings were ignored. Year after year, as profits skyrocketed, it was the cannery owner, not the biologist, who set the catch limit. The owner of the Houghton cannery, where the aquarium stands today, proudly declared,
"The sardine supply cannot be exterminated."
The constant demand for Monterey sardines matched the base seemingly supply of little silverfish. World War II led to yet another call from the Army for more fish, and Monterey Bay answered. At the height of the war, Cannery Row was processing 500 million pounds of sardine each year. Then, as quickly as the fishery had risen, in just 50 years, the Monterey sardines disappeared. By 1950, Cannery Row looked like a ghost town. The incredible boom a bust. The fishery became a shadow of its former self, and most of the canneries were shuttered. As I watched this unprecedented removal of fish from these waters, I knew that a fish as resilient as the sardine, with natural cycles of boom and bust, had limits, and those limits were being sorely tested. No resource is truly infinite. So, I hatched a plan. As mayor of Pacific Grove, I worked with the state of California to set aside underwater gardens, places where ocean life could be safeguarded, an idea that was unheard of in 1931. Today, gardens like these are called marine protected areas. I flourished in these underwater gardens, even as it flattened the waters near the canneries. They began to grow and expand, giving the bay a chance to heal.
Today, the waters before you are part of a marine sanctuary. This is the result of people like you and me recognizing the need to live in balance with nature, just like my ancestors did long ago.
The recovery of many of the local fisheries is evidence that the bay is healthy once again. Nature is able to heal itself if given a chance. Monterey Bay is living proof. The work I began nearly a century ago continues today. You can see for yourself. Take a walk along the recreation trail into my town of Pacific Grove, where you will see one of the most beautiful stretches of coastline in California. Harbor seals, dolphins, whales can be seen from the trail. They're thriving because of our work to help protect these special places. Marine preserves can be found all along the California coastline, and these waters are now some of the most protected in the world. Today, the Monterey Bay Aquarium works with the community. Fishermen, biologists, and lawmakers from around the globe, they're leading the charge to create more success stories like this one for our ocean. Your support of this aquarium is what makes this work possible. And helps ensure that we can all enjoy this incredible day. Waters beyond for generations to come. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of your visit at the Monterey Bay Aquarium.